Tonight we will be doing the sign language to the song, How Great is Our God. If you know the words, please sing along as we worship our Savior.
The splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
That was awesome. Whoa. Well, if you can't praise Jesus in that, I don't know how what it's going to take, do you? That was so beautiful. Thank you, young man, for that tremendous leading of worship. Please turn with me tonight to Philippians chapter 4. We're going to read the first 7 verses for the first portion of our sermon, The State of Contentment. The State of Contentment. That's a wonderful word, isn't it? The state of contentment. I hope every one of you are living in that state, that you're enjoying contentment in your life. Philippians chapter 4, verses 1 through 7. Paul writes these words to the church at Philippi. Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved. I beseech Euodias and I beseech Syntyche that they be of the same mind in the Lord. And I entreat thee also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand. Be careful for nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. And the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Notice again verse 7. It simply says, the peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Shall we pray? Loving Father, how we thank you that in every circumstance of life we can know your peace and tranquility. We can know, Father, the assurance that only you can give. We can understand, Father, what it means to be safe and secure in the hands of our almighty Heavenly Father. We can know what it means to have a shelter in the Rock of Ages. Father, we can know what it means to be secure. And, oh God, to have hope welling up within our hearts, regardless of the circumstances we face in life. Tonight, O God, we pray that every one of us will learn this great Christian art of contentment, and that every one of us will be consumed with the peace that only God can give. Father, bless our people tonight with the glad assurance that there is contentment in Jesus Christ in every situation of life. We pray in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I want to ask you a very personal question. Don't answer out loud, but I want you to think about it and meditate upon it as we progress through this text of Scripture, through these verses of Scripture tonight. And the question is simply this: are you enjoying the state of contentment in your life? Are you enjoying the state of contentment in your life? Perhaps to answer that question, we need to consider together just what it means to be content. You see, the adjective content comes from the Latin word contentus, which means to hold together or to restrain. Do we feel that our lives are holding together in this 21st century? Or tonight, do you feel perhaps that you're becoming unraveled, that you're beginning to fall apart amidst all the pressures of life and the circumstances that we're facing together? It's no wonder there's a lot of discontentment in our world today. You see, families all about us are not holding together. They haven't learned this state of contentment. They haven't come to understand the peace that God can give in every situation, in every circumstance of life. Not only are families falling apart, but personal lives we see are being distorted and broken and becoming fragmented. And there's not the hope, there's not the peace, there's not the security that God intends for us to enjoy. And I guess the thing that troubles me most as pastor these last 49 years is that even believers that I pastor are unhappy. They're in a state of discontentment. They do not have the joy of the Lord that God intends for them to have. Their lives are so fragmented. And oftentimes they live life without the hope that Jesus intended that they should have. My friends, the good news is that God has a mature contentment for each one of us that are here tonight. Not only those that are here, but our entire congregation. He has a mature contentment for every believer that's living in this world today. Do you know that you and I can say together tonight and truly mean it, I am grateful for who I am in Jesus Christ. Young people, are you grateful for who you are? I can remember as a young person, I had a lot of trouble with this state of contentment. I wasn't content to be 4'6" and weigh 77 pounds when I went into high school. Jonathan, you can't imagine that, can you? My twin sister couldn't imagine. But I'm glad that since that time I've learned contentment about who I am and the physical characteristics that God has given to me. And God wants every one of us to be content with who we are. I want you to notice as you look back to the book of Ephesians chapter 1 what the Apostle Paul says about each and every one of us. In Ephesians 1, looking together at verse 3, he said, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ." And then he says some things that are very meaningful. First of all, he says, "He has chosen us before the foundation of the world." I can remember as a little fellow on the playground when they picked teams, I was the last one to be selected because of my size. No one wanted me on their team. I was too little. But this verse says, I was chosen by God before the foundation of the world. Young people, you are chosen by God. He has selected you for a particular task. And mom and dad and grandpa and grandma, He selected us too, before the foundation of the world. And then it says something else. It says here that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. In other words, God has marked us for holiness and blamelessness. And He gives us the key to how that's possible. He says, in love. If you love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, the effort you make to live holy, the effort you make to live blameless, God accounts those as holiness and blamelessness because you're covered by the blood of Christ. You're clothed in His righteousness. And when God looks at you, He sees you through Jesus, His Son, slain from the foundation of the world. So we are important to God. And if we love Him and seek to serve Him and give Him our best effort, it's accepted. It's accepted. Wow, we can truly be content with who we are and what we have. And that's the second point. I'm grateful for what I have in Christ Jesus. Look at verses 11 and 13 of Ephesians 1. It says, "In whom we've obtained an inheritance, We have an inheritance right now, being predestinated according to the purpose of Him who worketh all things after the counsel of His own will, that we should be to the praise of His glory, who first trusted in Jesus Christ. And then it says in verse 13, in whom you also trusted after that you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also after that you believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise. My friends, we have an eternal inheritance if we've trusted Christ and repented of sin. My friends, we are created unto His praise and glory, and it's made possible by the sealing of the Holy Spirit in our lives. To as many as receive Christ, to those He gives the power to become the sons and daughters of God. Realize your inheritance in Christ and be content with who you are. I want to go on to say that mature contentment for you and me means that we will enjoy this present moment. Tom used to say concerning Larry Earl and myself, he said, Dad, you and Larry could have fun at a funeral. Now, I don't know all the indication of that or the implication of that, but he's saying, regardless of where you and Larry are, you seem to find joy. You're able to have fun. God intends for us to enjoy life. Do you believe that? I think the Christian should have the biggest smile. I think the Christian should be a joy to be around. I think the Christian should raise the temperature in the room when he walks in. It shouldn't begin to feel like a deep freeze when you're around a Christian. I think a child of God should be marked by joy. And mature contentment helps us to be joyful in every situation. When we're mature in our contentment, we will utilize the blessings God's given us to do what we can do for Him and for others. But may I say, mature contentment is never satisfied to remain at the level that it's at. Contentment is never indifference and complacency. In fact, the person who's maturely content is the person who's aspiring for greater things in Christ. Contentment does not mean we grow lazy in our faith. It doesn't mean we don't progress. It doesn't mean that we don't try new things. It doesn't mean that we don't reach higher. It doesn't mean that we don't stretch ourselves. Isn't that what Paul was saying in Philippians chapter 3? And turn back there with me. Philippians chapter 3, reading verses 13 and 14. He says, brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things which are behind and reaching forth unto those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. That is mature contentment. You say, Brother Abshur, how do we arrive at such a level of contentment in any circumstance of life? How do we arrive? Well, Paul offers us some steps, and please note what I say, this is a crucial word, in learning God's contentment. Contentment's not just like turning on a light bulb. Contentment is something we learn in our Christian walk. Paul had to learn these steps of contentment for himself. Notice, if you will, verse 11 in Philippians 4. He says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am therewith to be content. The great man that Paul was, He was a man of tremendous faith, but he had to learn contentment. It's something you and I have to work at. It's something you and I must purpose to enjoy in life. It's something that you and I must reach out for. It's not something that just happens. It's something we realize through aspiring to be mature, contented people in the faith. He was a man of unbelievable dedication. He said, "For me to live is Christ, and for me to die is gain." He traveled the then known world without the means of transportation. He communicated the gospel without the means of communication that we have. Yet this man had to learn contentment. He too found it difficult to be satisfied in any situation in life. It wasn't easy for Paul. He had to fight the fight. He had to keep the faith. But this great apostle learned what it meant to be content in any situation, even in jail. He learned contentment. My friends, we must work at contentment. We must take specific steps in our Christian walk in learning this grand art of graceful Christian living. First, in our passage of Scripture, we find that we must take the step of steadfastness if we're to learn contentment. Look at verse 1 again in our Scripture reading. Philippians chapter 4 and verse 1. "Therefore, my brethren, dearly beloved and longed for, my joy and crown, so stand fast in the Lord, my dearly beloved." If you and I are going to enjoy this Christian grace of contentment, we must stand fast in the Lord. This involves our relationship to Almighty God. Our relationship has to be kept up to date. We have to walk in obedience. If we fail, we have to be quick to confess our failure to God. We have to be poised in keeping the faith and being obedient to the commandments of God. Steadfastness is an essential foundation stone for Christian contentment. Not only must we be steadfast in our relationship to God, we must be steadfast in our relationship with each other. If we don't strive to keep right relationship with one another, this contentment, this spirit of contentment will seep away from us, and we won't enjoy what God intends for us to enjoy. This includes other members in the body of Christ. Some of the most discontented people I know are people who are out of joint with other people in the body of Christ. Always negative. Always critical, always judgmental. Nothing's ever right. It involves our personal family members. Young people, it involves our moms and dads and our brothers and sisters. To learn contentment, we must be steadfast in our relationships with each other. In fact, it involves all relationships with everybody. You're not always going to be treated fairly. You're not always going to have nice, good things said about you. Sometimes you're going to be the brunt of criticism. Sometimes people are going to be very unkind. But the thing we must remember in those times is that when Jesus was taking the brunt of the sins of the world, your sins and mine, He said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." If we follow His example in keeping our relationships, as far as we're concerned, on the highest level of Christian holiness and obedience, contentment is close at hand. for that child of God. There's a positive side to this commitment of steadfastness. If you look at verse 3, it says, "And I entreat you also, true yoke fellow, help those women which labored with me in the gospel, with Clement also, and with other my fellow laborers whose names are in the book of life." Contentment comes from serving others. There's no greater joy in life than helping other people. The smallest things we do to help others brings great reward. And the more you labor to help other people, the more contentment you're going to realize in your walk with Christ. My friends, we must work at contentment. We must take specific steps in learning this art of Christian living. The second step we must take to learn contentment is rejoicing. Look at verse 4. "Rejoice in the Lord always, and again I say rejoice." You know, we can get up in the morning and we can almost curse the world we live in. We can blame everyone for our circumstances in life. We can be a sourpuss all day long with the people we come into contact with. Or we can face life with a smile, with a light step, with a word of hope, with a word of promise. We can help people to learn contentment by the contented nature of our own disposition and life. Oh, my friends, I want to ask you something. Are our lives marked by complaining and griping and criticism and finding fault with others? Do we feel somehow that's going to elevate us above those about us? All it will do is pull you down, down, down. Are we learning to sing and praise God in our daily walk? Are we praising the Lord without being in worship service? Our youth fellowship or Sunday school? Are we learning that whatever state we're in, we can find reason to praise Jesus, to smile, to bless others, to encourage others? I pray that you and I will learn to lift others up rather than put others down. If we can learn that lesson, we can begin to rejoice in our spirit and help others rejoice along the way. Oh, my friend, may we find something in our present circumstances to give us satisfaction, to give us contentment, that we can praise God. The third step we must take to learn contentment is moderation. Verse 5 says, "Let your moderation be known unto all men. The Lord is at hand." Thoreau gave a splendid suggestion for contentment when he simply wrote these words, "Simplify." Simplify. What's he mean? He means we need to know and we need to learn that joy consisteth not in the abundance of things. It's not the clothes we wear. It's not the cars we drive. It's not the rings we have on our fingers. It's not the houses we live in. That's not contentment. It never brings contentment. Look at Hollywood. They have everything and they're miserable. Why? Because joy is not found in the abundance of the things of this world. And it never will be. We need to begin to learn how happy we can be with what we already have. And by the way, with the nation we're living in and the times we're facing, can I say this? We could even learn to be happy with less than we have. What if all that we have is taken away Are we going to be content? Are we going to have the joy of the Lord? Are we going to be able to praise Jesus Christ? Are we going to be able to thank Him anyway? Think about it. We've got to simplify. We've got to learn to be moderate in all things. The fourth step we must take to learn contentment is carefreeness. Look at verse 6. Be careful for nothing, but in everything by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known unto God. The Apostle Paul is saying to the church at Philippi, if you want contentment, if you want joy, real joy, stop worrying. Stop worrying. Mom said when I was a little fella, I was a worry wart, whatever that means. But I'll tell you what, there wasn't anything I faced that I didn't spend some restless time over. I don't care if it was a chemistry class, a biology class, or exam. I don't care what it was. If I was going to a doctor, I'd fret and worry about what he might find out. If I got sick, I'd fret and worry over what might happen. But I want to tell you something. I've come through the years to a place of contentment. I've come to a place of just trusting the Lord and knowing that the worst that can happen in this life, I mean, even if I die, I have a heavenly home. Amen? Do we believe that? We preach that. We sing about it. We teach that. Do we really believe that? I do. I do. And so we need to learn carefreeness. We need to thank God for each and every day. If we get diabetes, we need to thank God anyway. Regardless of what comes, if we have heart trouble, thank God anyway. We're still living. The heart's still ticking. If we get this disease, thank God anyway. He's our great healer. He's with us. His grace is sufficient. Even in the valley of the shadow of death, we fear no evil, for He's with us. You see, if we brood over our problems, I found in my life we only compound and multiply them. We fear the worst. We live life on edge. We don't enjoy the present moment. Don't let the enemy rob you of contentment. In fact, Jesus says, "Cast your cares upon me. Stop worrying about tomorrow, for sufficient unto this day is the evil thereof." What's he saying? There are always going to be problems. Don't concentrate on tomorrow. Don't worry about the future. Live today. Cast your cares upon Him and trust Him. Amen? In closing tonight, now, the rest of the story is going to come another Sunday night, so you'll have to come back and hear the other steps for contentment. But I want you to consider the glad result of learning contentment in your Christian walk. Verse 7, and I love this, it says, "The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, shall keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus." Sister Absher wants to rename where the blacktop road stops and the gravel road begins to go down to our house. Now, we got a neighbor down there. We'd have to get their permission. But she wants to rename it Shalom, the way of peace. Young people, there's no greater treasure than the peace that God can give you. Mom and dad, grandpa and grandpa, there's no greater pleasure in life than the peace that passeth all understanding that God can give you. The peace of God. Please understand, the world cannot give it to you. It cannot give it to you. All you search and all you do and all you attain and all you amass and wealth will never bring the peace of God. It comes from God and not ourselves. This peace the world cannot give, but neither can it take away. I want to ask you a question. Would you become a peace taker today? Would you let God give you the peace that passeth all understanding? Remember, to do this, we must purpose to be steadfast in our relationship with God and others. To do this, we must purpose to be a rejoicing Christian. To do this, we must be willing to be satisfied with less than we have now. To do this, we must stop worrying and live today, for sufficient unto this day is the evil thereof. Receive today the blessed peace of God and enter into a noble, into a whole new experience of Christian contentment. I love you, and I pray God's contentment upon you. If you have burdens tonight that are dragging you down, I want to encourage you to come and pray. Don't worry about what others think. Just come and pray. Cast your cares upon Jesus. Leave them there and determine that you're going to learn to be content with who you are and what you have. Let's stand together for a word of prayer. Father, we thank you tonight for those who've come to worship with us. And Lord, we know that you knew before we came who would be here. And so, Lord, we're so thankful that you fitted this message for us personally, that we can receive it from you and that we can learn this graceful art of contentment in our Christian life. Bless our people, God. There's so many, many circumstances in their lives. There's so many, many hurt. There's so many, many emotional downs and highs, oh God. And we just pray that you will pull them to you. And in your bosom, in the shelter of your arms, may they find the peace that passeth all understanding. We pray in Christ's name. Amen. Let's turn in our hymnals to 649, My Soul is Satisfied. If you'd like to come and pray about something or for someone that you know needs to learn contentment, you feel free to step out and come as we pray tonight. Here tonight, and I pray that you will underscore these steps for contentment and that you will practice them in your daily life And maybe there'll be some testimonies forthcoming in the future of this art of graceful living and the peace that God has given to you. You have a wonderful week in the Lord. Come back this Wednesday night and let's enjoy our